Well, this evening we're returning to Galatians chapter 6, and what I'd like to do is just simply read the four verses that we were looking at this morning. So I'll begin in verse 7 of Galatians chapter 6. Paul writes to the church in Galatia, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not lose heart in doing good. For in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. So then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith." May the Lord bless his word again to our hearing this evening. Now this morning we were reminded that we do need to sow, which means we do need to be investing our lives in something. God's kingdom is what we ought to be investing in. If we are to reap, we must sow. If we do nothing, then we'll reap nothing, we'll receive nothing. But we are also reminded that what we receive has a definite connection with what it is that we're actually sowing, what it is we're doing. We will reap only what we sow. And we do need to take into account some modifications. We do understand that when we sin, we don't reap the full consequences of that sin because we have been redeemed by the Lord and he has taken that wrath on himself on the cross. But what I meant to say this morning was simply this, that we will reap some consequences. There will be some corruption. There will be discipline according to the Lord's will. But he will work it together for good. But there are consequences. Paul says, if we sow to the flesh, we will reap two things. If we're outside of Christ, we'll reap destruction. If we're inside the Lord Jesus, it can corrupt our souls. We saw this morning that means that if we're outside of Christ, if we're practicing sin, if we're continually sowing to the flesh, we actually show that we are not born again. We show that we are outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sowing to the flesh in that situation means the reaping of destruction. Our sins will destroy us in the end. Of course, if we are believers, as I've said, and we involve ourselves in sin, there will still be consequences. It will corrupt us morally. It will weaken us spiritually. Now, likewise, if we sow to the Spirit, if we continually sow to the Spirit, that is the practice of our lives, doing what is good and what is right, we will reap eternal life and everything that has to do with that life, spiritual strength. If we practice righteousness, remember what John said this morning, then we are born of God. If we do what is right, if we live in the way that the Lord calls us to live, we show ourselves truly to be born of God, and we can know that we will enter into heaven. This is really the main way that we can know. It's not a warm feeling inside. It's not just simply a truth that's printed on a piece of paper. If I do certain things, if I pray this prayer, I'm going to enter into heaven. We can know that we are on our way to heaven by a life that is transformed by the Spirit of God, working from the inside out. And that transformation means we will continually be sowing to the Spirit. But we also saw more narrowly, it means that if we do what is right, we will grow spiritually stronger. And as Christians, that certainly is our goal. Now, we ended with Paul's warning where he says in verse 7, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap." We noted this morning that we might think that we can short-circuit the relationship between what we sow and what we reap, that we can sow to the flesh, that we can get away with sin, that it's not going to hurt us, or maybe that we can even grow spiritually by doing something we know the Lord tells us not to do, or without doing what the Lord actually tells us to do. Maybe we think we can grow spiritually without doing anything that the Lord tells us to do. But the point is, we can't. And Paul says, if we think that we can, we're only fooling ourselves. The law of cause and effect holds. Like always begets like. If you sin, it's going to hurt you. If you do what is right, it's going to help you. And it cannot be otherwise. And so, if we would be spiritually strong, if we would be useful to the Lord, if we are to be in a position where we can actually, where the Lord can actually do what he wants to do through us, we have to be careful to sow to the Spirit and not to the flesh. Now, this evening, I thought maybe we could spend some time applying this a little bit more, spelling it out perhaps a bit further. That is just focusing on that narrow part as believers. How can we avoid sowing to the flesh, and how can we sow to the Spirit, or at least how does Paul want us or tell us we should in our passage? Now, first of all, how can we avoid sowing to the flesh? Well, we do need to remember what it means to sow to the flesh. It means to do things that strengthen the flesh. And the only thing that strengthens the flesh actually is sin. Now, there is a connection between sin and the flesh, quite obviously. John tells us, first of all, what sin is. Sin basically is the breaking of the law, the setting aside of the law, the disregarding of the law to do what it is that we want to do. He says in 1 John 3, verse 4, everyone who practices sin also practices lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. How do we know what sin is? Well, it's the breaking of the law. Now, that, the breaking of the law, is exactly what the flesh wants to do. It is absolutely opposed to the law of God. And you can see, of course, the connection between flesh and sin. Paul writes in Romans 8, verses 6 through 8, for the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace, because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. For it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so, and those who are in the flesh cannot please God. By the way, this is how we can know that we are not born again, that we don't have the Spirit of God in us, is our reaction, our attitude towards God's law. If we are hostile toward God, if we refuse to subject ourselves to the law of God, if we are unable to do that from the heart, it means that we do not know him. By the way, that's also why those who are in the flesh, outside of Christ, cannot please God. The flesh, as Jesus says in John 6, profits nothing. It doesn't help us at all. All it does is hurt us. Now, every time we sin, every time we break God's law, we're resisting the Spirit of God, who is seeking to lead us according to God's law, and we are giving in to the flesh, and that obviously will strengthen the flesh. Paul reminds us that these are two opposing principles that are in the hearts of believers. Galatians 5:17. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, for these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. Do you want to know why you have a struggle to do what the Lord calls you to do? That is the reason why you have the struggle. If you didn't have the Spirit, there wouldn't be a struggle. You would just simply be hostile toward God and not submit to his law. But having the Spirit, having the desire to do what is good, creates this conflict. Now, when we give in to the flesh, when we sow to the flesh, it causes the flesh to grow stronger. It's feeding that opposing principle to the Spirit, and the influence of the Holy Spirit within us grows weaker. Now, this is certainly one of the things that Paul means when he says in our text in Galatians 6:8, for the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. Why is it that we find ourselves sometimes in a position where we can't do what we know the Lord wants us to do? It's because We've been sowing to the flesh. We've been doing things that are wrong, that are sinful. We have strengthened the flesh. We have weakened the influence of the Holy Spirit, who alone can give us the ability to actually do what the Lord calls us to do. We have to cut off these strengthening influences to our flesh. If you don't want to sow to the flesh, if you don't want to strengthen your fleshly desires, then you have to keep from giving in to your flesh and not break the commandments. Now, I think that is fairly clear in Scripture. One thing that isn't quite as clear is that this does not apply just to our actions, not to just what we say and what we do, but it actually applies to our thoughts, and it applies to our desires. If it's wrong to do it, if it's wrong to say it, it's wrong to imagine it, and it's wrong to desire it. And when we give in to those things, we still strengthen the flesh, even if we don't actually act it out. I think we see this most clearly in the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus was applying it to murder in particular, in Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 22. This is what he says. "You have heard that the ancients were told, 'You shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. And whoever says to his brother, 'You good for nothing,' shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says, 'You fool,' shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell." Now let me ask you, is breaking of the sixth commandment only the action of murder? No, Jesus says we can break the sixth commandment when we get angry. That is, in our hearts, we hate our neighbor, perhaps desire to do him harm. We can break the sixth commandment when we use our words to harm our neighbor and call them things that aren't too nice. We can break the commandments in other ways, but whichever way we do it, we are still sinning and we are strengthening the flesh. So we need to avoid not only the actions and the words, but also the thoughts and also the desires. Now, what about when you're not sure what the Lord actually commands? I mean, are there any circumstances, situations where that takes place? Well, I think so. And perhaps for a variety of reasons. One of the reasons may be that maybe we're not reading the Bible as we should, and so we just don't know what it is that God wants us to do and what he doesn't want us to do. The way that we take care of that particular issue is we read it and we study it. And perhaps the things that we think maybe are questionable or we don't know for sure, perhaps it's not quite so unclear in Scripture. And we can know what the Lord wants more clearly by simply reading it. But what if we've read the Bible and we still can't tell? What if we haven't reached the point maybe where we can fully understand what the Lord's will is in a particular situation, at least in some areas? I think that happens in some of our lives, or perhaps all of them. What if we've been surrounded for such a long time by other believers who see it in a particular way, and they've actually helped to train us to see it in that same way? That happens all the time. That's, of course, inevitable in whatever church we're in. We hear it presented in a particular way. We begin to believe it that way until we see something that might lead us to another conclusion. What if we've been deceived? The enemy's always trying to deceive us. He's always trying to pull the wool, as it were, over our eyes. What if we're deceived by the enemy? What if we're deceived by our flesh? I mean, our flesh, if it wants something strongly enough, it causes us to rationalize our sin so that we don't see certain sins as sin and maybe even begin to see them as something that is actually good. That happens too. As a matter of fact, Thomas Brooks, Precious Remedies Against Satan's Devices, he says one thing Satan will do is he'll come along and he'll paint vice with the colors of virtue, and he'll try to convince you that this is really a good thing. And that does happen. Now, what do we do in cases like this where we don't know for sure? Well, I would refer you to the wise advice that Susanna Wesley gave to her sons, I think all of her children. Susanna Wesley, I think, had over 20 children, but only 10 of them, I think, survived infancy. So she lost half of her children. So the 10 that she actually did raise, among whom were John and Charles Wesley, she gave this advice on this very matter. She said this: whatever weakens your reason impairs the tenderness of your conscience, obscures your sense of God, takes off your relish for spiritual things. Whatever increases the authority of the body over the mind, that thing is sin to you, however innocent it may seem in itself. Now, there's a lot of things that she actually says in this particular quote. We don't have time to unpack it all, but let me just simply say this. If we can't tell by what God says in His Word, take a look at how it affects you. Take a look at how it is affecting your life and ask yourself these questions. Is this thing that you're not quite sure of, does it strengthen your desire for sin, other sins, or does it weaken it? We're reminded by John Owen, the Puritan, that by committing any one sin, it actually strengthens your desire for all sins. And so if you're doing something you're not quite sure and you find that by doing this you're actually wanting to give yourself to other sins, well, then you should suspect that this is not a good thing you're doing. Does it draw you away from God and more into the world? Again, that's just another way of putting, does it strengthen your desire for other sins? What does it make you think about God and spending time with Him and worshiping Him and spending time in His Word? Does it make you resent God, resist God, and what He tells you to do in His Word with regard to your relationship with Him? Well, you see, if what you're doing has any of these effects, then it doesn't really matter what you think about this particular activity, whether or not it's sin. To you, it actually is sin because it's producing bad fruit in your life. And really, only sin can do that. And there is one other case where this can happen, and that is maybe you don't know. Maybe it isn't really sin, but you think it is. You know, you suspect it might be, and you do it anyway. That also can strengthen sin in your life. But again, because it has these effects, it is sin, and that's why it strengthens your flesh. And that's also why you need to avoid it, because as long as you continue to do it, it's going to weaken you spiritually at best and make you unusable by your Lord, at least to some degree. Now, we want to be useful. We want to be usable in this world. We want to do what is honoring to the Lord because it makes a difference in the short haul and also in the long haul. If you want to have a full reward on the day that you stand before the Lord, if you want to build as much as you can on the foundation the Lord has laid in your life by His gospel, you need to live with your eyes open. Take a step back and look at your life. Look at yourself. Are you growing into the image of Jesus? If you're not, or if you're not making much progress, then think about what are you doing that is actually hindering that growth in the likeness of Christ? What are you allowing that is hindering His work? Those are the things you need to identify and the things you need to cut off. Remember, as long as you continue to sow to the flesh, you will reap corruption. So we need to cut off the flesh. The same thing Paul is talking about in Romans 18. We need to put to death the deeds of the body. Now, another question to ask yourself is this, because there's two sides to this coin. You know, not only what are you sowing to the flesh, but what are you not sowing to the Spirit? Are you being careful to sow to the Spirit of God? Well, that's what we are going to look at here secondly. How can you do that? How can you sow to the Spirit? Well, this is really what Paul focuses on in these last two verses in our text. We can sow to the Spirit in the way we usually think about it, and that is worshiping the Lord. That's what we're doing right now. We're sowing to the Spirit, and the Spirit is sowing His Word within us, and He is strengthening us. We can do that together. We can do that in our households, in our families. We can do that by ourselves. We can pray. We can read the Word of God. We can celebrate the Lord's Supper. That's one of the reasons why we do it every Lord's Day, is because it's a way by which the Lord actually strengthens us as we remember His death, His love for us, and how He sowed Himself into our lives, how He invested Himself completely in order to save us. And of course, as we look to Him to receive the benefits of what it is He has done for us, not just salvation, but also the work of His Holy Spirit. We can also benefit by reflecting on our baptism. Remember, baptism is God's mark upon us, His mark of ownership. We belong to Him. Baptism is a sign of a spiritual reality, that we have been washed by the Spirit of God if we're trusting Jesus. We have been baptized into Christ. We are in union with Him. So we can think about our baptism. That's actually what it means. We can also seek the Lord through fasting. There's a lot of things we can do to strengthen ourselves spiritually, to sow to the Spirit, and to, you know, to reap the benefits of salvation. But one thing that Paul draws our attention to this evening is, if we don't go any further than this in our efforts, if we do not use the spiritual strength the Lord gives to us and do something with it to touch the lives of our brothers and sisters in the Lord, if we don't reach out to our neighbor to serve our neighbor, to reach them with the gospel, then in a large way, in a large measure, our spiritual growth will be stunted. And that is true. Remember what we've seen. Jesus wants to use us. He saved us. He brought us into union with Himself so that He might use us to minister to other people. He wants to work through us to touch other people's lives. If that particular goal that Jesus has for us isn't actually accomplished, if it isn't met, then His purpose is short-circuited. And when that gets short-circuited, our spirituality also gets short-circuited. And so Paul very naturally moves from this principle of sowing and reaping to the specific areas where our Lord actually wants us to apply this principle to our neighbors, and especially to our brethren. He writes in verses 9 and 10, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. So then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith." I do want you to notice that Paul here is equating the doing of good with the sowing to the Spirit, because doing good in the way He calls us to do is certainly not sowing to the flesh. But in doing good, we're sowing, and in sowing, we're going to reap. Notice, let us not lose heart in doing good, sowing in this way, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. Doing good is sowing to the Spirit. Now, what is this good that He is actually calling us to do here? Well, first of all, He says we are to do good to all people. We are to minister to them. That is, we are to serve our neighbor. And that really shouldn't come as any surprise. I mean, this principle is shot all through Scripture. When Jesus was answering the question of the scribe, what is the greatest commandment in all the Scriptures? And Jesus tells him the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all you have. Okay. Then He says, the second one is like this. Now, He didn't ask Him for the second one, but Jesus gave it to Him anyway. The second greatest commandment in Scripture is this, Matthew 22:39, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And remember, who is your neighbor? Well, your neighbor is anyone who is near to you. That's what neighbor means, somebody who's near, somebody who is in need. Jesus was asked that question on one occasion. Man was trying to justify himself. Well, who is my neighbor? And then Jesus tells him the parable of the Good Samaritan. He doesn't actually tell him who his neighbor is, but He does tell him who it is he should help. Anybody near you who has need, that's the person you need to help. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7, verse 12, "In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you. For this is the law and prophets." Another way of saying love your neighbor as you love yourself. Sowing to the Spirit, first of all, means loving your neighbor as you love yourself. Now, what we need to do, of course, is look around and see what the needs are around us and how it is we can help our neighbor. If we see someone who is hungry, the way to love them is feed them. If we see they're thirsty, give them something to drink. We don't run into people like this very often, but if we happen to find somebody who doesn't have clothing, we need to clothe them. But I think the main need that is around, of course, is to give them light. Our neighbor that's outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, they're in darkness. And if somebody doesn't shine the light to them, then they're going to die without hope, and they're going to go down into hell. That's what the Bible says. For their sin. There's only one escape, and that's through Jesus. So loving our neighbor, I think, primarily means sharing the gospel with them, and of course, to share the gospel with them, we need to build bridges. We need to enter into some kind of relationship with them in which we can help them. But the point is this, we need to go beyond wanting to help them and thinking about helping them. We need actually to help them. John writes in 1 John 3:18, a principle which I think applies both to brethren and to those who are outside of Christ. He says, little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth. Obviously, in Scripture it says too, if you say to your brother, sister, go in peace, be warm, and be filled, but you don't do anything to help them, what good is that? James reminds us. Faith, even so, faith without works is dead. We don't really love them if we're not actually reaching out to help them. So one thing we need to do is we need to try to meet the needs of our neighbor around us, and particularly we need to try to reach them with the gospel. It's not enough to desire it. We have to actually conspire to do it. And there's a number of reasons why we should do that. Christ commands us to do that. Paul tells us we should do good to all men. Obviously, Jesus is speaking through him. Care and concern for our neighbor, if we are to love them the way we love ourselves, we won't want them to perish, just like we wouldn't want ourselves to perish, and so we reach out to them. The Lord wants us to do good to them. But I want you to notice, secondly, and to conclude, Paul says there is even a higher priority than that, and that's something perhaps we don't often see, but we do understand is in his word. We are to do good to our brothers and sisters in the Lord. He writes in, I think this is verse 10, so then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith. So, yes, we are to do good to all of our neighbors, but particularly, he says, to the household of the faith. So another thing we need to be thinking about, if we are to be sowing to the Spirit and doing good, is what are the needs that we see around us in this fellowship? What are the needs we see in the larger community of faith, because the church is much larger than this small gathering? In the church that is in the world, Paul tells us that our family in the Lord Jesus Christ is actually supposed, well, is to be more important to us than our family in Adam. Our neighbor is a brother or sister in Adam. You know, we're all related in Adam, but those who are in Christ have the priority. As a matter of fact, if our own natural family is mainly in Adam, then our spiritual family may even take precedence over them. Paul says we are to do good to one another. We are to care for one another. This is what he is saying is perhaps the largest part of what it means to sow in the Spirit. And I think that simply means, again, ministering what we have to one another. Now, Paul tells us that if we are willing to sow in these areas, we will eventually reap a harvest. Again, he says in verse 9, let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. Now, we often think that if we minister to one another's needs, we're actually strengthening our brothers and sisters, which we are, but Paul tells us that we're also going to benefit, obviously, when we do this. We will reap if we do not grow weary. When we invest ourselves in spiritual things, we grow stronger spiritually. That's exactly what our Lord Jesus Christ did. He invested himself in others, himself. And when we do what he did, we not only grow spiritually stronger, but we also can look forward to a greater reward we will reap if we do not grow weary. Remember what Jesus said to his disciples after the mother of James and John came to him and said, Lord, would you please allow my two sons in your kingdom to sit one on your right, one on your left? Would you give them the greatest places of honor? Would you do, Lord, for them, for my children, single them out, treat them as special? Well, Jesus said this in response in Matthew 20, verses 25 through 28. Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great men exercise authority over them. It is not this way among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus sowed himself into his brethren. He became a servant, a minister to them. He became the servant of all. And for this, he also received the greatest reward. That's what Paul is pointing out in Philippians chapter 2. The one who is in the form of God takes upon the form of bondservant, but then becomes a curse for us in order that he might save us. And in so doing, he is exalted to the highest place of honor and authority. Jesus says, if you want to be great in the kingdom of heaven, if you want to reap spiritually, if you want to reap blessings, and I think not just spiritual strength here, but a greater place of honor and privilege in his kingdom, then you need to follow Jesus' example. You need to do what Paul is saying here. Do good to all people, but especially to those who are the household of the faith. The more that you do this, the more you humble yourself and become a servant to your brothers and sisters, the greater will be your reward. Now again, sometimes, you know, delayed results can be somewhat discouraging. You know, we do this for a while. We maybe don't sense what we see. Maybe things seem to go against us. Maybe we do this and we meet with opposition. We do this and we don't feel quite so spiritual. We do this and we begin to wonder whether or not there is going to be a reward. But Paul says, you may not see the reward, the results, the rewards perhaps right away, but he does say you will in due time if you don't grow weary, if you don't give up. You have to believe and you have to keep sowing. You have to keep doing good, and in due time you will reap. Basically, we do need to believe what the Lord says here. We need to believe we're not wasting our lives when we're not seeking to promote ourselves as the best and seeking a great name for ourselves. It's difficult to humble yourself and really to become somebody of no reputation like our Lord Jesus did. To be the one who is always serving and not the one who is being served, that's difficult. The rich and the famous are the ones who are served, and the people who are nobody are the ones who are serving. Jesus emptied himself of all reputation. He was the one at the Last Supper. Even his servants or his disciples knew who he was, but he was the one who got up and girded himself with a towel, got down on his hands and knees with a bowl of water and washed the feet of his disciples. He was the one serving. We need to believe that when we follow Jesus' example, that we are not wasting our lives, we're not wasting our opportunity to get what we can get out of this world. Well, in a certain sense we are, because we don't want what this world has to have, but we are seeking a greater reward. We're investing our lives into something that we will be able to keep forever. The things of this world, remember, we have to leave behind when we go to be with the Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ was the greatest man who ever lived. He's the God-man. He was the one who had the greatest intelligence. He was the one who had the greatest gifts. He was the one who could have been the greatest ruler of the world. He even had the opportunity. Remember, Satan offered it to him. But he gave up all of these things, emptied himself of all reputation, was even willing to be nailed to a cross to become a curse for us. Curses everyone who hangs on a tree, the scripture says. When Jesus was nailed to the cross, it was clear that he was cursed. Cursed of God. And he was cursed of God because he was bearing our sins. And he was willing to become a curse for us in order to free us. But again, he could have had that greatness in this world, but he gave it all up in order that he might have greatness in the kingdom of heaven. So if you think this is wasting your time, then you're going to have to say Jesus was wasting his time as well. But you know he was not wasting his time. And you aren't either, and I'm not either. When we invest ourselves in the kingdom of heaven, we too will receive a reward like Jesus did, one that we will be able to keep forever, riches and honor in the kingdom of heaven. So believe what the Word of God says and seek to follow Jesus. Do good as Jesus did. Follow his example and continue to be faithful in that, knowing that you will reap in due time if you do not grow weary. May the Lord help us all to do that. Let's spend a moment in prayer and ask the Lord to apply his word to our hearts.